Good morning. This is Amber Sullivan with The Financial Brand. I just want to thank everyone for joining us today for this webinar from Backbase and The Financial Brand, 2019 Outlook, the three key trends that will impact digital-first banking. Before we get started, we'd like to let everyone know that the recording of this webinar will be available shortly after the webinar has concluded. If you have a question, please use the questions panel on the dashboard and we'll get to as many as we can today. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Jauk Pleiker, CEO and co-founder of Backbase, and Tim Rutten, VP of Strategy at Backbase. I'll let you guys take it from here.
Hey, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining. I'm here with Tim.
Good afternoon, good morning, everyone.
All right, let's go to the next slide and kind of get this going. Yeah, there we go. So what we would like to discuss, Tim, here is software platforms and technology companies are completely changing the world, right? Mm-hmm. So if we look at some of the examples here, maybe you can give a little bit about context about Uber, right? This is one of those little apps.
Yeah, so if you think about the statement here from Marc Andreessen, of course, a captain of industry, if you will, the statement really holds true that software is eating the world. And you see this across the board in multiple different categories, if you will, different mm-hmm. verticals. Classic example by now is Uber with its application that really disrupted the taxi riding market. I think the interesting takeaway from this this particular brand and the application is the fact that they have been extremely disruptive, right? In terms of pushing the boundaries on many levels.
Yeah, and how does this relate to banking, right? So transportation is a regulated industry. Mm-hmm. And let's say 5 years ago or 8 years ago, there's this new kind of challenger that basically says, forget about all the regulation, forget about everything, forget about brick and mortar, forget about taxi licenses. We are just going to create a technology platform. And with that platform, we're going to empower both the end user as well as the taxi driver, and we're going to connect to them all together. And I think what we see here is that it's kind of the fact that with that little model, now it is a company that, of course, we all know is kind of dominating around the globe with a market cap of more than 60 billion US dollar, maybe even more. I think this is the signal that digital transformation and change is not something that is completely radically new. I think we already have seen the use cases, the real world examples in other industries outside of financial services, where smart new business concepts that just take a mobile operating system, a mobile device, a platform technology, some Google Maps, some capabilities to make a payment. And if you kind of glue them together in a seamless customer journey, you can completely disrupt an industry. And I think one of the key topics today is that we are very concerned about the fact that this is actually happening right now in financial services.
Correct.
Another example you will see over here, it has all the similar dynamics. It's Airbnb. It is, again, it's a platform. It is omni any touch point, and it's kind of brokering. It's almost kind of creating its own economy, right? It's kind of creating a whole new profit model for people that have a spare room. They can rent it out, and it kind of generates a whole new set of income streams for hundreds of thousands of homeowners around the world. And the dynamics are exactly the same. Unlike the hotel industry, you don't have to own all these assets. You are extremely asset light. You just have the technology, and you kind of broker supply and demand. And again, also kind of this little example is not new. It's proven, and it is scaling very aggressively around the world. And we would like to discuss today that similar impacts will happen in financial services in the next five years. And of course, the next one, I think we all know this example. This company is only 20 years old. It kind of started as a nice bookstore, but only in 20 years, look at the impact of a digital platform that is just kind of organizing commerce, right? Today is probably one of the most valuable companies on the planet. And again, just like the other two examples, at the heart of this is a platform, a technology platform that is kind of operating and kind of matching supply and demand. Good. So if we kind of zoom in a little bit more and we look at the underlying model, we call this the rise of digital platforms. And what you see here on the left side, you have the traditional incumbent business models. They are asset heavy. So you need branches, you need call centers, you need stores. If you want to expand into different geographic markets, you need to kind of duplicate all those assets. And then on the right side, you see the platform business, which is much more scalable. It is asset light, it is technology centric, And because it's digital, you can actually really quickly scale. You can scale within one particular market segment, but you can also scale with multiple product groups. You can scale to multiple countries. You can scale to multiple target audiences. So it's a very cost-efficient, very flexible model. If you look at the cost-income ratio of the platform business versus traditional business, because the platform business is so asset-light, probably the underlying cost model is a fraction of the traditional business models. Maybe it's of course it depends a little bit, but especially also if you translate this to banking, it could be that these digital only, digital first kind of platform economics can operate at one third of the cost structure of a fully loaded classic asset heavy bank. So that kind of gives them a complete different business model and also a very different break even model before they can flip into a profitable economics. All right, so digital disruption, it's happening. Here you see a nice overview of what has already happened in the past. Again, digital transformation and digital disruption is not new. We're fortunate enough that we already have seen this happening a few times. So already from the 1995s with music and with video rental, then the second wave, we've seen it with e-commerce, with travel, with the Netflixes of this world. And today we are probably in the third wave of digital disruption. And in this third wave, roughly from 2015 to 2025, banking and insurance and especially financial service as a whole is in the middle of this third wave. All right, so let's kind of explore what this will mean. And I think in a typical digital disruption wave like we just saw, in an era of, let's say, 10 years, something very profound is happening. And we've already seen this happening two times now. The incumbent business models will completely be basically replaced with new digital first business models. So the outcome could be either that the incumbent business model, as you can see maybe over here, will completely disappear. Let's talk about the DVD rental store concept. It's basically completely gone, or a CD, so to say, right? So there's kind of those examples. There's also examples where it's not completely disappearing, but it's kind of dramatically reduced in market share. So a reduction of 40, 50, 60, 70% reduction in market share. And it's all lost to these new digital models. And then finally, of course, the positive side is that these new digital models that are typically platform centric, lower cost, lower economics because they are asset light and extremely scalable, they take over. And I think then the key question is that who are kind of owning these new digital business models? Is it the challengers? But it could also be kind of the incumbents that are aggressively enough kind of making the transition from the incumbent business model into the new digital business model. But that requires brave leadership, where you need to really say this is not like a little change program, but this is about disruption. So that basically, how do you disrupt yourself? And how do you kind of really take the courage to kind of create a new organizational culture, a new operating model, where you really dare and decisively move from phasing out the incumbent business models and proactively experimenting with these new digital business models?
If you look at this this particular image here, Jouk, given that there's a timeline on the x-axis, where do you think we are in terms of timing?
Yeah,
the flipping point.
It's hard to tell. I guess right now we have hundreds of people attending this webinar in all parts of the world. So it probably depends country by country. Mm-hmm. But we, for sure, you can actually say, and it's probably also in the next one here, is that you know we're probably there, kind of getting closer and closer to kind of to the full tipping point. Mm-hmm. It's not early days anymore. There's in my mind, and if we look at the market right now, I think there's definitely a larger sense of urgency. Compared to 2 years ago, because some of these new business models, they really go fast and we will explore them. But you see it with digital payments. You now really see a bunch of neobanks that are not just funky fintechs, but they are accelerating like a Netflix or an Amazon in the early days. So I think we see more and more data points in the market that the momentum of these new digital models are really accelerating.
Yep, it's really happening.
So there is, in my mind, it's accelerating and is also getting more urgent. And if you then compare that with some of the speed and the decisiveness some of the incumbent banks, it gets kind of almost like a very concerning combination, because the lack of urgency or the lack of the, there's this understanding to go for digital transformation, but the decisiveness in execution is still very much kind of, I would say, almost like slowed down by the incumbent business model or the incumbent organizational culture.
Yeah.
All right, so I think the major topic for today is, and that's what we mean with digital first, given the urgency and given the fact that we are in this third wave and the data points really show that digital disruption is now happening in financial services with both fintech and big tech. It's attacking it from multiple angles. It's happening now. So from 2080, where we still see in the majority of the banks and the credit unions that digital is important. There's a digital transformation program. There's a digital strategy provided by you know, a strategy consultant. But most of the digital stuff is still on the side. So there's a great mobile app with a 4-star rating. There's a nice innovation lab. But if we're really honest about it, it's a little bit like digital pixie dust on the side. It is good. It's moving in the right direction. But if you compare it to an Amazon or if you compare it to a digital pure player, you have to be honest, and it's pretty much still on the side. It is not in the core. So today's topic is, how do we become digital first bank where digital is really at the core of the business model? And that's kind of the major topic for today to explore. Who are the banks that are progressive in this? Who are progressing? What are they doing? What does it mean for their business model? So we would like to kind of explore mostly the business model aspects of how to get there, right? So if you look at kind of this digital first mission, I guess there are three major pillars to kind of to take into consideration. At the top, you see the customer experience. And I think what you know from Backbase already, it's all about who owns the customer experience? How do you control the customer experience on the glass? And how do you kind of make those kind of customer journeys completely digital, completely paperless, and get remove all the friction? Just make it as easy as that Uber app or that Netflix type of experience, right? Highly tailored, no friction, super smooth, all digital, all that stuff. And we've been discussing that many, many times. For today, we would like to kind of move a little bit more to kind of the business model focus. What does it mean for the underlying economics of the business model? And how do you kind of become competitive in this new digital first world? That's the topic for today. Maybe in a future webinar, probably in 6 to 8 weeks from now, we will also then actually look at the execution speed. Mm-hmm. Is that okay? Great. How do you actually do it? What are the best practices in kind of transforming a traditional incumbent business model and bank into a more digital savvy, digital first type of execution engine? But for today and for now, it's the focus will be on the business model.
Yeah.
So, Tim, if we go there.
Yeah, let's dive in directly. So if you look at the business models that are, let's say, prevailing, or at least, yeah, taking over in the digital world, we have a few observations. First of all, you could conclude that we're currently in what we would call the fourth industrial revolution. And I won't dwell on it, but basically today it's really about being digital to the core. So not just having something on the side like Jaap just alluded to, but really properly being a digital firm top to bottom. In doing so, let me give you a very brief example, actually with a very traditional type of business, like the hotel business. If you look at the slide, you see two elements here. You see the size of assets of the company, as well as the ecosystem that they're leveraging. And if you look at this example, which is Hilton, of course, Hilton as a group, they own a lot of real estate. They own all the different employees that are in the value chain to deliver the service, making them very asset heavy. It's a very traditional business, if you will. If you compare this to a, let's say, platform business, a truly digital first business like Airbnb, they have a very lightweight footprint. Like, their assets are pretty much non-existent if you compare it to how they're leveraging the ecosystem. And the ecosystem obviously being all the spare capacity in the world, meaning you're renting out a piece of your house or you have real estate that you're looking to rent out. And the way they approach the business is very different from a traditional play like Hilton. If you compare it to Uber, they don't own any cars. Hilton, they own all the real estate. Airbnb doesn't own anything. Of course, there's also a little bit of a mixed reality where there is a bit more of assets at play, like Apple. They do have a retail world where you have stores you can actually walk in, but they're also playing heavily on, let's say a platform play where they have the Apple Store,
the App Store
with all the third-party applications in there and taking a major cut on it. Meaning we have this whole range of trade-offs that we can make between being a traditional business, being mixed, or being a fully platform-based type of business. If you think about the rollout and the low cost that you will find between between Airbnb and Hilton, obviously the comparison is quite aggressive, meaning the amount of rooms on Airbnb is explosive compared to Hilton, given that they can scale through. The amount of openings per year is, again, 10x, if not more, given that they have a platform. And I would say the most interesting part here is that the cost per opening of a room on that platform is, over time, it's around $0. We briefly touched on this already, the comparison between asset-heavy traditional businesses and digital platforms. So let's explore a bit further. One thing I would like to add here is that with a traditional business, you can only grow linearly, right? You need to increase your footprint in terms of real estate to open up new hotel rooms, for instance. With a digital platform, I think it's very clear that you can really grow exponentially, and there's a moment where you break even. We're going to skip this one. That's going to take too much time. But effectively, the topic for today is how do we actually build these new digital business models, and what are the ingredients that go in there? What are the value drivers?
Yeah, let's also then really explore how you do this in financial services, right? So it's kind of nice to see the analogy with the Hilton and the Airbnb, but let's now really try to translate this into banking.
Yeah, perfect. So in order to do so, let's get some inspiration from the best.
Yeah.
We have a few examples here. We're all familiar with the Spotify's out there and the Netflix's. They have a subscription-based model based on a platform, which they're using to service their customers. Spotify obviously being music, Netflix being entertainment, anything related to media, movies, and series. If we bring this into banking, we basically find the newer brands that are, well, literally they have a very significant uptake, I would say the last year.
Yeah.
And that's the Revoluts of this world and the N26s. And also these players are effectively doing exactly as the examples we just shared. Think Airbnb.
So it's kind of interesting, but here, like, we also have a lot of people here in the US attending the webinar, right? So they are maybe less familiar with these brands. They maybe remember Simple or Moven. That first generation, respectfully, I would say, didn't really scale of the neobanks. So for a moment, I think also in the industry, we're thinking like, okay, neobank, nice UX, but it's not really going to scale. It's not going to move the needle to become a threat. Apparently, these people that originally started in Europe, they do much better.
Yep.
They right now actually are globally expanding. So they're moving to the US, they're moving to North America, Canada, they're moving to Singapore. They're really scaling globally. But these guys, they do move the needle, right? They went from 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million. So their pickup rate is very impressive, I would say.
Yeah, and I would say Revolut in terms of numbers right now is very aggressive. They
moved
from 3 to 4 million in under half a year.
So, and they also kind of apply a freemium model, right? So you've got a free entry level, you can onboard like in a couple of minutes, you got the app, you got it pre-funded, you're good to go. And then they try to kind of do the uplift into something like an Amazon or, sorry, like a Spotify
or
like a Netflix type of subscription. You pay roughly $8, $10 a month.
Yep. Yeah, correct. It's a very similar model. So we're seeing patterns that we've seen before on the other players.
Yeah.
And that's also the interesting thing here, which in terms of fintech and let's say challenger play, they're doing something else that's very interesting to understand. And we would call it value aggregation.
Right.
Meaning Revolut and N26 or any other player for that matter. And we have another example in a minute. They are very smartly capturing the user experience. They're owning the digital channel, if you will. And below that, they're combining all these different types of players that can't make it on their own. So that aggregation, that combination of the right products and the right, let's say, value proposition is making them or is giving them a killer proposition in the market.
So just to kind of then to recap, what these people do, like if we analyze the formula is it is a digital platform first.
Yeah.
With the platform, they create a superior customer experience. Then they are basically giving that platform and that user experience away for free, then they scale to 4 million users and beyond. Mm-hmm. They really claim to be the Amazon of banking, if they continue to succeed. Momentum is quite good. Then out of that, let's say 4 million users right now, 8%, it's 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%, whatever, will go into the premium model where they start to generate at least, $8 to $10 of income per month. for the service, because the consumer actually wants to pay $8 per month for that superior customer experience.
Yep.
And then on top of that, they generate another revenue line, which is basically these third-party capabilities where they have the resale fee.
Correct, like affiliation.
Like affiliates or whatever, and they start to do the lending and the pension and all those, all those other elements.
Yeah, an interesting thing is you see it across the board with all these different players. They're looking to achieve it. And
so
I think
it's not just a monoline, right? With this, they're basically moving significantly beyond just you know, a nice debit card type of capability into a full service lifestyle type of financial service experience.
Yeah. I guess the interesting data point there is that typically it was regarded as, hey, it's just a monoliner, it's just checking accounts, you can't make money there.
Yeah.
But at scale and at, let's say, this impact level combined with the other third-party capabilities, it becomes extremely compelling and extremely competitive. Plus, they have a different speed of execution.
Yeah.
So that's
what
I would say.
What we basically see here on the screen is almost like this could be Amazon only 3 years in its kind of growth curve.
Yeah.
Or this could be an Uber just running, you know, for in San Francisco and New York, and before they were globally expanding, right?
Yep.
That maybe it's true, maybe it's not true, but these guys definitely have something.
Well, the other example would be Netflix, right? They were loss leading for a very long period. They didn't own their own material. They were all licensing it external until they got to a certain point and started producing their own.
Well, to be honest, these guys are not even loss leading. These guys can be very quickly, they are either, I think if they're loss leading, they are doing it by purpose because they're scaling.
Yep. That's the name of the game.
Yeah, clear.
So, yes, we know these numbers. It's a rough subscription fee that you find there. Just a picture depicting the fact that they are doing value aggregation. And over time, you are seeing that these players, although the dates are a bit late, they are putting more and more into their value proposition. Perhaps as another example to allude to the US people on the call, Marcus is a digital brand brought by Goldman Sachs. An interesting thing is there that they really went for two specific products that they wanted to disrupt the market with, or at least bring to market in a different way. And that's basically with fixed rate loans, as you can see on the screen, or deposits, basically savings accounts. And in doing so, they leveraged the ecosystem that Goldman Sachs already had in place. So basically the platform capabilities that are already there. And they started complementing that with third-party capabilities to bring something to market that was very simple for those two product lines. And what you see there is that within quite a short period of time, Marcus was able to already get $1 billion in total personal loans issued within 8 months, meaning significantly faster than the other fintech players out there, which is another way of looking at the challenge here, meaning it's not only the fintech challengers that can go fast, it's also an existing incumbent that by making the right decisions and by combining whatever they already have, they can also make speed.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting
So this is an example of an incumbent that actually decided to kind of embrace a very similar business model compared to these fintechs and started to kind of disrupt itself, or at least kind of create this new business line.
Yeah, correct. Clear. Correct. Yeah. And if you look at the numbers, like they have significant uptake, right?
And I think the nice part is that this presentation is already, we've been using it in the past. This is already outdated.
This is dated.
This is dated.
By at least
probably,
half a year.
It's probably right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Meaning traction on
so
all
next time update our slides, Tim.
Sure. So if you think about the key ingredients then for those business models we've just been looking at, they're asset light.
Yeah.
It's all about value aggregation and smartly moving the needle on your business model and taking more inside your business model as you go over time.
Yeah.
And of course, playing the scaling game.
So if we think about asset light, right? So an operation like an N26, it's probably 400-500 people max.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's below 1,000. Maybe
sure.
Right now there's kind of scaling and international expansion. So, but compared to another bank, it is relatively a relatively small operation with a very big impact.
It's super lightweight compared to the typical banks, and you'll find it in the cost income ratio.
Yeah.
And we have a little bit.
And
of
that's also, and I think, nice with the value aggregation. Apparently, you don't have to own all these product lines, right? Apparently, you don't have to do all the product management and all the financial engineering. You can also basically go to market much quicker and much faster by kind of creating these partnerships and go with a resale fee. But I guess there, with the value aggregation, in order to kind of play that game, you need to own the customer experience.
Absolutely,
right?
And you need a platform to do so.
You need a platform, you need to own the customer experience, and then you are in a position to kind of basically almost like capitalize on that loyalty and on that traffic to do the cross and upsell to these added value services, I guess.
Yeah,
cool.
All right, I think it's very clear. This game, this whole play is about reaching the break-even point.
Mm-hmm.
And indeed, when you do so, keep scaling and keep tuning your business model as you fly, depending on how you want to operate. So I think that the real takeaway for everyone on the phone, especially if you are indeed in an incumbent business model currently, you have to start experimenting with new business models. I think the traction is real. It's not early days anymore, as we just discussed. And I guess it's valuable to look at some inspiration, Jauke, again, but then specifically at a digital first bank that we believe is showing some output.
So this is the probably some of you recognize the logo. It's the Development Bank of Singapore, DBS. And they kind of said, okay, a couple of years ago, I believe around 2014, as you know, one of the most established, largest players in the region, the best way to fight disruption is to preempt it and to disrupt ourselves. So they were very clear about it. And in if you look at kind of this quote, it's a nice quote, but it's probably easy to say, but then you also need to be very bold in how to actually execute it. So they basically say, okay, how do we become a digital first bank? How do we get there and how do we drive this? So what they basically said, okay, we have some business model choices, right? So one game plan could be the one you see here in the top. Let's take our existing core banking infrastructure and let's put a digital banking interface on top of it. So let's call this the digital front end strategy. The second strategy could be, let's not even go with our legacy systems, but let's go with modern, lightweight, cloud-based, lean new core systems. Let's apply this new digital bank front-end on top of it to own and to master the customer experience, so basically the greenfield experience. The third model is, okay, we can actually then also kind of aggregate from multiple suppliers, fintech suppliers, combine that, own the customer experience. So let's call this the value aggregator. And then the fourth one is basically a combination of all three above. You continue to reuse some of your core systems. You can do tactical partnerships with fintech suppliers, and you really focus on this customer digital first type of customer experience. So let's call that the full digital transformation, where you take the existing bank, but you also kind of mingle that with new capabilities altogether. So they were able to kind of say, okay, roughly every bank, including DBS, but also everybody here in the audience, you can basically kind of take inspiration from these different game plans. And that's also what you now see around the world. We see it happening at scale that most initiatives and most banks we see are pretty much in one or more of these different kind of game plans.
Yeah. For the DBS Bank, they basically went all in. So they have their regular bank called the Development Bank of Singapore, and this is just an example of their webpage.
Yeah.
And on top of this, they started a full-blown new greenfield bank, which they called DigiBank by DBS. And in that one, they went digital to the core. And in reality, they did it on both ends. So they basically chose two models.
Yeah.
Right on the mothership, they started applying.
This one is like, how do we change the mothership? How do we really transform the incumbent, or I wouldn't say legacy, but how do you change the traditional bank?
Yep.
And then this one for emerging markets, right?
For emerging markets, yeah, correct. So they selected a few markets where they didn't have presence yet.
Like India, like Malaysia or Indonesia, some of those emerging markets. And they said, okay, that's the best way to also. But also they had to, because over here, I think we will discuss this, the cost income ratio of this digital first bank is significantly lower compared to the traditional bank, I guess.
Yeah, correct. All right. Yeah. All right. What we're going to be showing you today is basically a few takeaways from their digital transformation investment days. Like, they make it that important that it's such a big theme. And what you find there is that we were able to basically look at the value drivers of digital. Like, what does it mean to have digital customers? What is the cost savings and so forth?
Yeah.
And it is the first time that it's properly quantified.
So that's really nice. Yeah? They are now in this digital transformation program for roughly 4 to 5 years, starting in 2014. And they now, in their investor updates, they effectively report on data points about how effectively they are executing their digital transformation program.
Correct.
And the impact on their business.
Correct.
Nice.
And it's the first time that you see the effect of digital in numbers, bottom line.
Yeah.
So what we're looking at here is the P&L of 2017. And what you find here in the top bracket is, first of all, the amount of customers, income, cost, and profit.
Yeah.
And what you see here is a T and a D. The T means traditional customers, so they literally segmented out traditional customers that came in via the offline channels and are existing. And they also weeded out the digital customers, so people that onboarded digitally, for instance, via the DigiBank. And what you see there is that there's quite some interesting, let's say, takeaways from those numbers. And I'll just open a slide here to make sure we get to the details fast. So first of all, what you see here is that digital is material. And we're not going to run through all the numbers, but effectively around 40% of the customers are contributing 60% of the income and 68% of the profit. And this is really on the digital side. That basically means that digital customers are more profitable across the board, if you look at the whole P&L of 2017.
Yeah.
If you look at the bottom line here, sorry, the bottom container here, a few key indicators. I think the main interesting one is the income per customer.
Yeah.
And what you find there is that from a traditional customer, you get 0.6. And a digital one, you get 1.3.
2x, wow.
It's twice the amount of income per customer. And we'll identify why that is the case in a bit. And of course, the holy grail, the cost income ratio over here, 55% compared to 34% in digital, meaning it's 20 percentage point lower cost income ratio, which is, it's extreme.
Yeah. Right?
It's a very extreme number, I would say.
Very cool.
If we then dive a bit deeper, just to make it a bit more, let's say, explicit, of course, we know that we can either lower costs of serving a customer, or increase income. Those are basically the strategies you have. And if you apply those to DBS, you find a few things. So first of all, by going digital, they were able to lower acquisition costs across the board. So in consumer banking, think the regular retail banking that you're familiar with, it's 43% cheaper to onboard digital customers. So the acquisition costs are significantly lower. And you have the same impact on SME banking.
So if we kind of translate this to, let's say, incumbent banks, this whole customer onboarding topic is kind of, and customer enrollment is a major topic.
Yep.
So if we kind of learn from either these neo or fintech banks or from a bank like DBS over here, apparently if you automate and digitize this properly, you can pretty much reduce your acquisition cost by half.
Yep. Correct. That's what we're seeing here, both in retail as well as in SME. And of course, across the board, this could be a reality.
Of course, it requires an upfront investment in digital onboarding and customer account opening, but then this could be the impact.
Wow. Correct. If we then look at the actual engagement, and that's basically how often are they using the touch points, you see a very significant difference between a traditional customer that you see here on the left bottom, who also has access to the online channel, versus a digitally onboarded customer that, sure, might go to the branch once a year, but in essence is consistently using the online channels, the mobile applications, and so forth. Basically giving you a very significant impact in terms of the amount of touch points you have with your customer base.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the interesting part here is that it starts translating into something else, which is extremely interesting, which is the higher income.
Yeah.
And what you see here is basically your revenue mix per customer.
Yeah.
And of course, with a traditional customer, you have the same mix. But with a digital customer, they are literally across the board seeing on average twice, let's say 2x impact in terms of the amount of income per customer in consumer banking.
Yeah.
Which, sure, you can dive into details more. Is it because of the engagement, the product mix, the ease of use, and so forth? But I think these numbers are quite impressive already on its own.
They're really encouraging. I was just thinking about, you know, the third wave and banking and how important it is to basically own the customer experience and then kind of the subsequent. These economics are great, right? Mm-hmm. But how do you get there? As a consumer right now, if I think about entertainment, I think about pretty much one app, maybe two.
Yep.
Netflix, Spotify, maybe Apple. But it's like, so already that category, which was from wave one or wave two, basically it's now completely dominated by a handful of apps that basically are on my smartphone screen and control everything in that domain.
Winner takes it all almost.
Yeah, so but it also really means who owns the app to manage my money, right? I think that's the battle. So if we go back here, and especially we look at higher engagement, it's not just about the customer experience or some nicer, higher engagement percentage, but it's about the crucial battle by 2025. Who owns the app for a consumer or for a small business owner to control my money, right?
Yes, correct.
So frequency, high engagement is almost critical, because if you don't have that frequency or if you don't have that engagement, you're irrelevant.
Correct. You'll be surpassed by the ones who do.
Right. That's exciting and concerning.
It's both. Correct. We see similar impact on corporate banking. Just
same time.
Wow. Same thing.
Same numbers, like almost twice.
Yeah. It's very impactful. And then if you bring all of that together, you basically find, yes, we are reaching a higher income on the digital customers that we onboard, and you find a significantly lower cost to serve those customers.
It looks like the cost of service is pretty much like the same, maybe even slightly higher, but the fact that the income is higher kind of also then automatically generates higher profit.
Fully offsets that that cost level. Yeah, sure. Correct. Okay. And that, of course, drives from a 2015 perspective, your cost income ratio, which was 45% for DBS Singapore and Hong Kong, drives it down to 43% on the mother bank.
So this is the traditional
this
bank,
is
right?
The traditional bank, right?
Yeah.
So they were able to move it 2 percentage points down, which on its own is already a good number. They're looking to move it below 40 over time, right? That's really their aspirational level for the coming 3 to 5 years. If you look at the digibank, that is at 30% at this moment. And that's really serving those emerging markets where
India,
they have
Indonesia.
A digital footprint only,
yeah.
India, Indonesia. And yeah, I guess those numbers already give us a clear guidance that it is possible. And if you fully go for becoming digital to the core and really making it a major move as an organization, you can reach those levels and be relevant and stay relevant.
I think it's very encouraging to see these numbers. And I think already in e-commerce or in entertainment or in the music industry, it's not a new story, right? We've seen the move. We've seen those cycles. So it should not come as a surprise, right? It's written on the wall.
Well, 2 years ago, nobody would take it serious.
You could almost argue this is the new normal. Within the next 5 years, this is the new normal.
Yeah. Correct.
Clear.
Correct. And it's already there, to be honest, if you look at the actual challenges.
All right.
All right. So the actual question then becomes, how do you make the leap? How do you play in this new world? And what are the options you have?
Yeah.
We know we need to cross the chasm.
This is one of the key challenges, right, for traditional banks. And I think it's very clear that traditional banks will not go away. And traditional banks have great assets, great brand reputation, a very large install base. Mm-hmm. So that those are kind of all the positives. But on the other hand, it's then also how do you kind of build that culture, that agility, that kind of technology competence type of DNA in order to effectively make the change. So I guess that's the crossing the chasm, which is maybe quite a strong term. It's not about a little change program. It's not about, let's say, a very friendly, fluent transition, right? It probably requires a little bit more brave, maybe bold, maybe decisive, to really embrace kind of that digital culture.
Yeah, correct. It's like a pivot in a way.
It's a pivot. It's a very significant pivot. Yeah. Right. Okay. Let's analyze that a little. Of course, we have the business model. So I think this is quite clear, and we've discussed it. So there's no one formula.
No.
That's the good news. There's multiple formulas, and you can basically experiment with multiple models, and you can also properly, if you have the assets and then the means to do it, you can do them in parallel.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. But if we then kind of really kind of say, okay, we can actually, I think if we look at the bigger picture, I think the bigger challenge then really is eventually cost income ratio needs to go down significantly.
Yeah.
If you look at those numbers from DBS compared to an average bank, mm-hmm. let's say in Western Europe or in North America or in other parts of the world, they are 50% plus, right?
They are significant, yeah.
So that's still a huge difference in kind of underlying cost structure, right?
Correct. Yeah.
So partly is really kind of fundamentally leveraging digital platform technologies and different digital business models to lower the cost. It's not a nice story, but it's probably it's a necessity to keep the business model competitive.
Yeah, yeah. If you don't make a move, you're just going to be worse off, and you're going to be losing customers. So that's twice, twice negative.
Then on the other side, increasing the revenue, I guess partly it's about kind of removing friction, easy customer onboarding, kind of making it all super smooth and super easy. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, then it's also about engagement.
Yep.
The more, the higher the frequency of the engagement, the more touch points you have, the more interactions, the better the upsell and cross-sell opportunity is there. And then you can do value aggregation, and you can kind of, correct, I guess, bring these things together.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's kind of the theory, right? So mm-hmm. let's... What we really liked about the investor presentation from DBS, they asked themselves a very good question, and they say, if we know we need to go there, we know digital is there, that it's not the question about should we do it, we need to do it, that's clear. But then the bigger question is how, right? And they asked this very smart question: what would Jeff do? And then, I think everybody in the audience can can kind of picture that in their own mind. But very likely, Jeff and also Amazon would go in pretty bold.
They would go all in.
They would go all in, but they also would go in with a very big focus on technology, I guess, mm-hmm. right? They basically say, we're a retail company, or of course we are an entertainment company like Netflix, but the underlying thing, we basically are a technology company at the core. We need to embrace technology, and we need to embrace a digital competence to really master on our own, with also a more, I would say, experimental type of culture, to place bets, little bets, bigger bets, and to kind of work your way through. So it's kind of, it's more risky. It's more bold. It's more...
They would make a very aggressive move.
Yeah, so compared to most of the banks, it is quite out of your comfort zone, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's an interesting thing that DBS on their own put that in front of their board. Like, what would a potential competitor like Amazon do? You know they will play hard. You know they will make an aggressive move. And you know they are digital to the bone.
Yeah.
So that was also their conclusion. Yeah. In order to play in this game, although the slide isn't there, we need to be digital to the core. That means moving from legacy to true, let's say, agile digital platform.
Okay, so this is the attitude part. Hey? We looked at the underlying business model, the economics. They look very tempting. They look the right thing. We've seen it in previous cycles. So what does it mean as a traditional bank? How can we do this?
Yeah. So in essence, if you look at Netflix, Spotify, Amazon, Uber, all those types of players, and sure, they're scaling now and they're great and you name it. They're doing one thing really, really well. They're eliminating friction, right? And they're really strongly focusing on customer needs, and they're combining those with business goals, obviously, meaning they have a tremendous focus on experiences that are truly solving a certain issue. For instance, with Uber, it's very clear that it's the best and most smooth way to get a cab, to get a taxi. Same thing with Netflix. It is the easiest platform to consume your media. It's just that simple. With Amazon, it's the best e-commerce experience you can get out there.
Yeah,
that's what they're nailing in terms of serving their customers significantly better.
Yeah, and with that, I guess then you can also get that top of mind position. You get that, you kind of own that spot on that home screen of that smartphone to be the number one app for
you're the go-to.
Whatever category, you know, entertainment, transportation, manage my money.
Yeah, you're the go-to because they really nailed the experience, and we call those connected experiences because it really solves a customer problem. And the more scale they get, it's basically self-fulfilling prophecy. They really become the leader.
But that's also kind of thing, part of the formula, right? Next to kind of being brave and bold and kind of embrace it, like what would Jeff do? It, then also it really starts with what we've been describing, like outside in.
Yep.
Start with the customer. Start with resolving, removing the friction, really making things easy, the 10 times better experience. But then also, if you do that properly, you can also really match that with a very competitive business model that is correct. Actually servicing the financial institution.
Correct. Yeah. But fully agree, it does start with the customer. And in the Amazon world, they're customer obsessed, right? It's a very, very aggressive statement in a way, but that's how they roll.
Yeah, so customer obsessed, removing friction, and then leveraging digital. And that digital part, I see a lot of banks say, let's outsource this.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, you don't outsource your core capability.
Well, but there's also people here in the audience that, you know, they don't have a massive army. So
yeah,
how do you deal with that?
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, you could outsource it potentially. You can use a provider that runs the show for you. But at the same time, digital is much more than just the platform. It's also your culture. It's the way you approach it. It's the way how you build out your product stack.
Yeah.
And that combination is it's not just technology.
Yeah.
And there you. You could buy a platform like Backbase, but you and I both know that you need more ingredients to get there.
Clear.
Yeah.
So where to start?
Very good question.
So here we have a bit of a diagram, and if we look at the diagrams, how do we create value? And we love the simplicity of this little diagram. On one end here, it says kind of what is the effort to kind of do something, so it's either low or high, and what is the value to either your customer or the value to the bank. Right, so everything that has low value and is high effort, of course, it's a no-go, right? That's easy. Low, why even bother? Also, same over there. And then, of course, low effort, relatively high impact. So it's kind of nice if you look at your total portfolio. I guess a lot of the banks out there, they do have this kind of, yes, we're in on digital transformation. We have a chief digital officer. We have this big McKinsey study that tells us that we need to go here. Mm-hmm. But then, okay, out of this whole portfolio, where do we pick our winners? What we have seen instrumental in kind of getting momentum here, because we also see digital transformation is about disruption, and disruption is painful. So it's not a cozy ride along. So there are rougher elements on the journey. So therefore, also mentally, it's important to build momentum. And to build momentum, you need quick wins. Mm-hmm. Right. So it is very nice, actually, to kind of look at kind of the total portfolio out there and also look at potential technology providers out there or people with the right skills out there to make a consortium of the right technology components, the right skill sets, to kind of bring them together and then really focus on quick wins, mm-hmm. building that type of momentum.
Yep.
So you become more confident, you get more encouragement, also senior executives kind of get the right type of excitement, they get the right confident levels, and then from there you can start to work on your portfolio, right?
Yeah, correct. Yeah, what is interesting to see there is that from a back-based perspective, what we typically see in the market is still quite a waterfall way of thinking, meaning you have a roadmap for the coming 2 years, and there's a lot of ideas and there's a lot of capabilities you need to deliver.
Yeah.
What we typically do is let's focus on the coming 6 months and what value can we really deliver within that time frame, if not shorter.
So right. You want to go live within 6 months, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's the new norm. That's the new
speed. The new norm.
If
definitely.
If it's bigger than that, something is wrong. You could argue, right?
There's way too much in scope, for sure. Yeah. So we call this a committed product plan as Backbase, and that means these 6 months we are going to deliver these capabilities. And for instance, if you're working with a vendor like Backbase, the interesting thing becomes that you can fast track these types of journeys. And the interesting thing there is you can actually go even faster with more scope, given that it's actually available out of a platform setting, which has capabilities and journeys and basically yeah. value that you can bring into an implementation.
Clear. So I think that's also maybe I think it's good to emphasize. We see it as our core mission and our core responsibility to basically help banks to kind of accelerate their digital transformation for all the reasons we've been discussing. So if you think about how can you really help a bank to kind of get this on the fast track? I think the strategy part is for the bank, how to decide what your culture is for the bank. But what a company like Backbase can actually bring to the table is a whole bunch of accelerators. We basically, in the last 10 years, kind of created this kind of digital first platform. It's almost like the Netflix for banking or the Uber or the Amazon for banking. All the underlying critical digital technology ready to go, modern architecture, cloud ready, AI ready, modular, extensible, a completely industrialized platform. So that part you can really skip. It's almost like you now see a lot of retailers actually decide to kind of run their retail operation inside Amazon, the Amazon platform. So instead of competing with Amazon, they basically kind of take the Amazon infrastructure, including the logistics, to kind of drive their go-to-market strategy. I don't want to compare Backbase with Amazon, but what I do say is that some of these ingredients, those critical ingredients, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can basically kickstart. And then on top of that, we kind of provide those end-to-end capabilities for smart banking, for small business cash flow forecasting, for peer-to-peer payments, for frictionless bill pay type of capabilities, all there to kind of ready to go. It's kind of almost like a Revolut or an N26, pretty much white label, ready to go. But with the great thing, so it's industrialized, it's ready to go. You can pick and choose to really go to market aggressively. But then the great thing is you can also really tailor it and extend it and kind of customize it to your own needs. We recently we spoke with Forrester, and they kind of described this kind of, okay, everybody needs to do digital transformation, but how do you do it, right? Mm-hmm. They call it kind of buy and build. So you buy the platform to basically kind of get the kickstart to kind of accelerate, and then you build and you extend, not for the full 100%, but just for the areas where you really need to differentiate and where you need to customize and where you need to kind of integrate it in your own unique landscape. That's kind of, so it's kind of almost like a very nice way to kind of turbocharge your digital transformation. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can take it from the best, and then from there you can kind of make it your own.
Correct. And if you take that approach,
yeah,
you basically find that you have, as you see here on the slide, an industrialized platform, right?
Yeah.
Which is really the Backbase platform as an example.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the left, you find that there's many, many core ingredients. It's your existing systems, but it's also everything outside of your own boundaries. And that's really where the challenger examples that we showed today
yeah.
are playing, right? They are going for the value aggregation. And
yeah.
in order to do so properly and really drive those experiences at the level of Uber, at the level of Netflix, you need a platform to orchestrate that properly.
So here at Backblaze, Tim, you are doing a lot of work on the product management and on the product strategy side, right? So are you guys, and I, of course I know it, but if you look at, what can you tell a little bit with the audience, what are you guys doing on these kind of connected experiences? So what is kind of the vision there? What are the, yep, what is the value component there?
Yeah, so you mentioned one nice example just now already. Think of the Backblaze platform as an out-of-the-box accelerator, which you could compare to a Revolut turnkey that you can start running as your own business, which you can tweak on top of as much as you like across all the different spaces, be it in the retail banking space, be it in the SME banking space, the corporate banking space. We effectively deliver connected experiences, if you will, that are complete, that are turnkey for you to go to market with.
So if I understand this correctly, if these Revoluts and these N26, if they basically potentially are the new Amazons of banking, mm-hmm, you say with Backblaze that we provide a white label offer to kind of basically for any bank or credit union out there to hedge against those guys.
Get up
it's
to par directly.
The ultimate hedge. Correct. To kind of get even, to get parity.
Yeah, correct.
With the exception, of course, that you get parity on the technology side, but not per se on the culture or on the execution side.
Correct.
So on that side, how are banks doing?
Yeah, so the real question then is, how are banks doing in terms of culture to adopt a platform, to really play digital and bring that to life?
Yeah, I guess there are believers and there's people that like to do it, but there's also a lot of, I guess, learning out there and you know, trial and error to kind of get there. So let's stay on the positive side. Do you see patterns where you work with clients that they kind of eventually get impactful?
Yeah, I think the real good examples are the ones that, just like the DBS Bank example, truly go all in and they really place their bet on digital and they really focus their leadership on digital and everything they are and do in their daily business.
Yeah.
The ones that do it not fully, not all in, like they don't really have the right leadership, they don't have the full buy-in from, for instance, the top management team or the board, they are struggling and they don't get the right capacity, they don't get the right, let's say, flywheel to really make an impact. And I think the real organizations that have that impact are the ones that are truly looking to go there and are willing to, yeah, really become agile and deliver within 6 months and basically appreciate the way of working agile, which is never going to be feature complete day one. Yeah. And that's one of those mindset elements that in this space are quite hard to deal with sometimes.
Yeah, clear. All right. And then I guess next to kind of those connected experiences, if we look to the left side, kind of those core ingredients over time, I guess with the platform, you know, the platform in the middle, it will kind of do the digital experience. It will do identity, security, cloud, process, you know, paperless, straight to processing, machine learning. All those core engines are there. But what I really like then is also over time, when you get your base solution in place, then it almost becomes a little bit creative, right? Like creative as in business modeling.
Yep.
Can you talk a little bit more about the left side? Because of course we need to integrate to our existing banking system, but I would say almost that's kind of the, I wouldn't say boring, but that's more like a necessity, right? It's kind of make sure that the light goes on and off.
Yep.
But then beyond.
Yeah, so the interesting part is there that sure, you need to see your accounts, you need to look at my transactions, I want to be able to make a payment. Zero differentiation, obviously. Where it becomes interesting is, of course, depending on your region, your product proposition and the combinations you can make there, you could start introducing third-party capabilities that are really in the financial space, but you could also imagine bringing in capabilities that are not necessarily financial products that drive, for instance, the vision of everyday banking, right? So that you can really be supporting your everyday life with all the different things you're looking to do where a bank can help you. An interesting part is there that you find players like Revolut and N26 already showing the way in reality.
Yeah,
they are already making those combos, and that's where you can start getting creative to bring products to market that are not just banking products, but they're actually lifestyle products in
and
a way.
Also, to be clear there, I guess if you talk about those integrations or kind of, you know, a mashup of different capabilities, I'm sure that you're not talking about a multi-year program.
No. No, these are small experiments. Think, let's say, 2 to 4 weeks. You should be able to launch a certain capability.
That's very aggressive. 2 to 4 weeks?
Yeah, let's be aggressive. If you're truly as fast as a Netflix or an Amazon, you will deliver
fast.
Well,
if you look at the Revolut, they are pretty much like launching 2 or 3 new capabilities per quarter, right? So they probably have multiple squads, so they can actually have multiple focused teams to drive those innovations in parallel. Mm-hmm. So you can do stuff in parallel. Also, within a quarter, you can do multiple capabilities, depending on the team capacity. But then we basically have to prepare for a future where we innovate at least on a quarterly heartbeat.
At least.
In Go. Correct. But it also means that you can introduce features that actually, although you had high hopes and the prototypes were great and the initial user feedback was encouraging, they will fail.
You might learn that things fail, but it's also that's basically the whole play you're in.
Yeah.
Right? You need to validate fast, you need to bring new things to market,
yeah,
and learn whether they work, yes or no. And I think in general, that's also a mindset that's not always in place within an existing incumbent organization.
It's fair to say that most of these organizations are risk averse, and there's only one option, and that's success. So even
correct,
if the project is a failure, it's still a success, right?
Correct, yeah.
So that's kind of, I guess, the nice thing about if you look at these the rules of the culture of the Amazons or the Netflix of this world. It probably also took Amazon. There are many, many stories of let's say, failure. And failure is actually almost like celebrated, because failure was just a learning cycle. You got insights, and throughout the cycle, you know what works and what doesn't work. And then from there, you continue.
Correct. Yeah.
And it's not failure. It's basically just the little price you pay to get insights and to learn.
Yeah.
Right? It sounds philosophical, but...
No, in a way, it's already true, right? Because if you look at the newer players, and how they are, let's say, pushing the boundaries. They already put, let's say, product tiles in their applications, and they're checking how often they're getting, let's say, utilized or activated.
If we go back to the Revolut example, or we don't have to go there, but if we think about like all the stuff they have been integrating in the last 24 months, I'm convinced that, you know, quite a few of them won't move the needle.
Correct. But still, from an end customer perspective, it seems like they are pushing the boundaries. They're innovative. They are really looking to, let's say, help you in your everyday life, which could be as simple as, hey, you bought a new iPhone. Do you want to insure it via us? Yes or no? In their experience, which obviously goes to a third party.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems very tactical, but for an end customer perspective, it's, wow, that's actually quite cool.
Yeah. So there could either be an engagement or a retention value. Just great service without kind of any commercial top line or bottom line impact.
Yep.
Or it definitely, you probably would have kind of areas where these kind of services really contribute to top line or bottom line, and others are basically in the long tail and debatable how much time you would like to spend time on it.
Correct, but give it time and these platform players and the way they operate will find combinations that are just superior.
Cool.
Yeah.
We're approaching the full hour, so
yes, we are.
Let's go to the takeaway.
Let's do it. So a key takeaway for today, we looked at digital first business models and what are the key ingredients.
Mm-hmm.
Asset light, value aggregation as elaborately discussed, and of course, they're going for the numbers and you need to get to a certain level of skill. If you then think about what does it mean to become digital first, it does start with the customers. If you look at the
outside
left
in.
Part, outside in, business and customer value first. In the center, you see business model agility. Effectively, you have multiple flavors, and you need to figure out for yourself where you want to play. And of course, doing so at speed and getting at the right level day one that you would like to do with a platform that's pretty much already there and gets you a kickstart.
It's the kickstarter.
Directly.
It's the accelerator to get almost, you know, I would say to get even, right? To get on par. It's the ultimate hedge against those neo players.
And move from there.
Yeah, sure. Great. So there's quite a few questions here already in the chat box. So for those that, if you like to ask questions, you can use the, what is called the question and answer tool of the GoToMeeting console, which is probably on the right side of your screen. There are already quite a few questions and we will go through a few of them.
Yeah.
The first question is, will the deck be made available? And the answer is yes, most likely already by tomorrow. Both the deck in PDF format as well as a recording will be made available online publicly.
Mm-hmm.
And we will send all of you an update email so you can find the right location. Both the deck as well as the recording will be shared. Let's go to one of the questions here. I quickly need to read them. So, Tim, maybe can you please talk a little bit more about the value of digital first banking usage from a consumer perspective? Why would a consumer do it? Why are they choosing to go with a Revolut or an N26 or a Marcus?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Given that currently the data points are limited, I'm guessing that from a life cycle perspective, these new digital only banks are still quite early days. Meaning you have a lot of early adopters that find it cool and are looking to stay current. I think at the end of the day, it's really about making it as seamless and frictionless as possible for the end customer. And I guess we can all tell from our daily lives that getting a mortgage or insurance product or changing your address with the bank, for instance, is just challenging. And the ones that are solving that issue will get the attention and the usership.
I speak a lot of people of every age range, business people, consumers, and what they all say, the fact the onboarding of those apps is unbelievable smooth. It is within 2 minutes, regardless of the country you're in. So the smoothness of the onboarding is number one. Then the fact that everything beyond that point with anything you need from a self-service point of view is pretty much frictionless. I know a guy, he's the CEO of one of the top companies, and he's using his classic bank. I won't mention the name, but he had to change something and he had to go to the branch or he had to make a difficult phone call. That guy switched to N26 because I said, I had this application. I had the account just on the side, secondary, but because my bank makes it so difficult for me to change, yep, I give up. So I think a lot of the consumers actually will start to use these neobanks, not as their primary account, but they will go secondary or tertiary, whatever it is. But the fact that everything is smooth over there, eventually, typically from any moment you will have friction with your primary bank, you'll say, unacceptable.
Just switch.
Just switch.
Yeah. And the switching costs are very low, so.
There is almost no switching cost. Yeah. If you also look at open banking and account portability,
yep,
if you take that trend in kind of into the mix, it's going to be even more more easy.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. So I think the number one is ease of use. We don't expect consumers in the end of the day, they do not expect friction. I think one of the reasons why these conversion ratios from the freemium into the paid model for the Revoluts and the N26 is so high. And I have a few insights that these conversion ratios are high, very high. So the people that actually move from free into paid is very significant. And the reason for that is that actually basically means the convenience of the app. Apparently, people now say that I am willing to pay $8 or $12 for Netflix. I'm paying $10 for Spotify, and I'm paying $10 for a bank that makes things easy. That's just money service,
yep,
right? Imagine they are paying more than 100 euros or dollars per year for convenience. It's impressive.
Yeah.
And then we're not even talking about any income from your balance sheet. We're not talking about lending, the core of banking. We're just talking about fees that people are willing to pay for seamless experiences.
Yeah.
That's I think that's really critical. A lot of new questions are entering here. One of the questions is, does Backbase provide consulting services for digital transformation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good question. So as Backbase, we're of course a software company, so we sell licenses to the Backbase platform. But on top of this, we have a pretty sizable customer success team across the world who work day in, day out together with our customers to basically go through the digital transformation and run the implementation. So yeah, we have a lot of exposure on that topic as well.
Yeah, customers that actually go with Backbase and decide to kind of leverage the benefits of the white label platform and the accelerators and the solutions, we are basically very much in this transformation journey together with you. So Backbase definitely goes beyond just technology services and technology implementation advice, but we have a vested interest for you to kind of succeed, and we help you with strategy, user experience design, digital transformation, process changes, all of those aspects.
Yeah. Let's go for the final question, given that we're on the clock.
Yeah. So maybe there's a few little questions. Changing the culture, how to drive it through? That's very difficult, right? This is probably, if I may say so in a very respectful way, maybe this is the elephant in the room.
Yeah. Yeah. This is what we see every day.
Yeah.
In all honesty.
And we see a lot of believers also in that, but over time we do also, and that's the encouraging part, we are meeting more and more banking executives that really understand the urgency of change. And also the importance of kind of really embracing different and getting new DNA into the bank. I would say more DNA from the tech world, DNA from agencies, DNA from service design. Mm-hmm. But then also, how do you kind of create an organizational model that if you actually hire and attract that type of talent, they are not frustrated by, let's say, the incumbent or the legacy operational model, right?
Yeah.
So what I would recommend for the audience here, there's this very nice book. It's written by Eric Ries. He's the original author of The Lean Startup. But he also wrote a second book, which is about the startup way. So it's Eric Ries. The title of the book, you can buy it on Amazon. It's called The Startup Way. And it basically describes that how can you actually transform large enterprises like a General Electric or a large bank or a large telco for that matter? How do you kind of create little pockets of entrepreneurial behavior inside the day-to-day operation of that bank? How do you do procurement? How do you do legal? How do you do compliance? How do you kind of create an environment that you cannot completely neglect? Your culture is what your culture. Also, your traditional process is there. But as an executive, how can you make a change, a transformation program where you kind of create safe spaces for these new digital talented people to really make impact on your core business? And we're not talking about a bunch of hipsters in an innovation digital lab, but we're really enabling digital talent inside a traditional organization, step by step, to give them more space and more freedom. And I think the key thing is that actually move away from risk, move more into an operating model, an organizational model, where you allow these people to take smaller risks, to take smaller bets. So it's about small autonomous teams, and they have assumptions that typically you call them leap of faith assumptions, like let's validate this new product integration or let's go with this new feature, and then allow them to kind of fail quickly. So that doesn't mean like a multi-year program. It means a program of a couple of weeks where an autonomous team actually gets the space to actually really drive this feature end to end with real end customers and kind of start to innovate like that. It's not a total answer, and I think you certainly cannot change culture overnight, but culture change starts with getting new DNA on board, but then also don't frustrate that DNA with old process. So I think it's also very important to get inspired by best practices from the LinkedIns, the Silicon Valley type of companies, how they organize themselves about little squads, teams, autonomous teams, feature teams that can go end to end. And how do you kind of give them the freedom actually to experiment and to learn? And not like in an incubator, but in real, for real, in the life, with live customers, with live systems. Sounds a little bit scary, but I think there's a lot of good literature already out there. And there's a whole bunch of industries, go to Silicon Valley or go to any tech startup, that do this already for a living, day in, day out, for the last decade. So the recipe is out there. It's totally out there. It's more about the willingness to learn from those recipes and get inspired by those type of companies and basically pick and choose what is valuable for you, right? Pick and choose what great artists steal. So why not get some inspiration and go into that kind of learning journey? There are still many questions here, but we are already over the hour. So for the remaining questions, we will try to answer them to you either via email. If not, please don't hesitate and feel free to reach out via email to Backbase. So it's info@backbase.com. And we're more than happy to engage with you and to give you some additional insights or compare notes. That's it for today.
Yeah, thanks for listening, everyone.
Thank you very much. I hope it was worthwhile your time, and we look forward to reconnect with you probably in 6 weeks from now. We will continue this series about digital first banking and the transformation progress. And next time we are going to talk much more about the last question, and that's actually how to do it, how to change the culture and how to change the process, the operating model. What we are going to do, we're going to go into real-world examples, so not very theoretical, but like very pragmatic, very down-to-earth do's and don'ts about how to kind of step-by-step kind of change the process and the culture to behave more like basically the startup way. So looking forward to reconnect with you in 6 weeks from now. Thank you very much for now, and have a great day. Bye-bye.